is out of line. I've got a cat-sized vessel with 8 people in the water. I'm fixing to pick them up.
Hey, it's me, Destin. Welcome back to Smarter Every Day. Today on Smarter Every Day, we're going to continue our deep dive with the U.S. Coast Guard, and we're going to see how they accomplished their mission of saving people in peril and protecting the nation from maritime threats. In previous videos, we've learned about command centers and the command structures, and we've learned about search patterns and the RBM, the response boat medium, with its fascinating control system and remarkable maneuverability. There's still a ton to cover with this series of videos, and today we're going to spend a Memorial Day weekend with a Coast Guard station in Destin, Florida, and see how the Coasties go about keeping the boating public safe on one of the busiest boating days of the year, particularly at a place called Crab Island. If you've ever been to Destin, Florida, you have heard about Crab Island. It's a barely submerged intercoastal island where the masses love to come and hang out together. So today, let's go visit the Coast Guard station in Destin, Florida, and get smarter every day. So how do Coast Guard stations actually work? We know the boats are there, and that's the part that does the people saving. So are they more like a fire station where they're waiting on things to happen, or is it more like a police station where they're like going on patrols? If you've ever been to Destin, Florida, you've heard about Crab Island again. It's known as the local party spot. But what I didn't know is right beside Crab Island is Coast Guard Station Destin. I pulled up to the station and met BM1 Seth Pritt, who introduced me to the man in charge, Senior Chief Corey Palmer.
I'm Destin.
Senior Chief Corey Palmer, good to meet you.
Yeah, pleasure.
It was pretty early in the morning, so we just had a few moments to show me around the station before the team on duty was gathering for the risk assessment meeting for the day.
So this first building kind of walked into is our administration building. Mm-hmm. And then over here we have our communications room.
Hey, I'm Destin.
Sean. So we have a computer program that picks up. We're working with 4 different towers here. Channel 16, International Hailing and Distress, and then these two are Coast Guard channels, so this is how we talk to our boats while they're underway.
So this is the International Hailing and Distress.
Yeah.
These are Coast Guard?
And then, yeah, these two are Coast Guard, and then this is for more detailed marine information.
Oh, really?
So you can like switch to 22 Alpha, that's a Coast Guard working frequency.
So we got some flippers here.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Yeah, they're the real deal.
Yeah, they tend to break less often.
And this is I learned not to call this a map, this is the chart, right?
Yep, that's correct. That's our chart there, one of the charts we use.
Okay.
So this here was just kind of our general, you call it like a bullpen or something, but just general office space for the folks that come in, need to get on a computer, they can hop in here. Back there, that's our operations petty officer. BM1 Seth Pritt here.
That's right. You get it done, right?
Yes.
That's right.
He's probably the busiest guy at the station, I'd say.
Awesome.
And then back behind you, we got our armory. And just...
Is the armory.
Yep.
Okay.
So after this, the senior chief showed me the mess hall and the crew quarters, the downstairs garage, which serves as the headquarters for all the maintenance they do on their boats. He also walked me out to the boathouse, where they pull the boats in and work on them, and at that time, it was being used as a temporary gym while they remodeled the permanent one.
So we have 4 Coast Guard boats that are here. The rest of these boats are our partners in the area that... we all kind of work together to get the job done.
Senior Chief Palmer then showed me the 3 boats they use, the big one being the 45-foot response boat medium, and the other 2 boats are the 29-foot response boat small and the 24-foot boat special purpose craft shallow water, which we'll be out on later. We headed back to the station for a GAR, or General Assessment of Risk, where the team meets and goes through the various risk factors they're facing for their mission today. It's a really interesting collaborative effort to establish what they should be looking out for in terms of risk. After this, Senior Chief filled me in a little bit more on this whole Crab Island phenomenon.
All right, Senior Chief, I have set up a camera here, and Crab Island is starting to bake off. How does it go down? Like they're standing up out there, right?
Yeah. So most of that
people
that
are
area
just standing
is
there.
Pretty shallow. They can just kind of stand next to their boat, hang out, enjoy themselves. But as kind of the day progresses, so many boats will be on there that you're not able to get to that. You'll be right on the edge where the deep spot is. And that's where the current will be kind of pushing through there as the tide changes, and it can be pushing as much as 3 or 4 knots.
What's the most common injury out there?
It's hard to say. There's really a wide range of stuff that can happen. But some of the more severe ones are drowning.
That happens here?
Yeah. Yeah.
You think it'll happen today?
I hope not. I really hope not, but
that's terrifying.
Where some people come to visit, they're not necessarily a swimmer. They don't know how to swim. They kind of get that false sense of reassurance, like, hey, we're just going to be in 3 feet of water. You can just be standing the whole time. as the day goes on, they work their way closer to that deeper, that drop off, the edge of the sandbar, and the current gets them, and then they start drifting away, and that's when they get in trouble.
Oh man.
Yeah.
That's awful.
So Senior Chief wasn't exaggerating. As you can see in this time lapse, over the course of the day, Crab Island kind of builds up and gets crazier and crazier. A little later in the day, we loaded up in the 24-foot special purpose craft and headed out on patrol.
All right, so what are we about to do?
Pretty much we're doing a recreational boating safety patrol. So we're going out looking for anyone that is doing anything that, you know, is not safe, looking for BUIs, anything, you know, that may be not legal. We're making sure, you know, everyone's safe. We're going to check safety gear, make sure everyone's good to drive their boats today.
So, like, if I don't have a mustache, can I still hang out with you guys or what?
Well, yeah, I don't have one, so.
I noticed the guy that doesn't have the mustache is the one that has to drive. So you guys just sit around and look cool on the deck.
Well, he barely has one.
I barely have one.
I count it. It's better than I can grow.
It's all a facade, you know?
Yeah. Safety's the priority every time we get underway for any evolution. You know, if we see something that looks like, oh, that's not right, you know, we'll stop a boat, potentially run some field sobriety tests if it, you know, it comes down to that.
So what on earth is that?
Those are the tiki boats. They're just floating little pallets that got a 60 horsepower engine on the back and just scoot around. You can book them out. So I think it's BYOB and you got a captain that drives you around all day.
The captain's sober the whole time and they just do their thing.
Yep.
That is bizarre.
It's brilliant.
It's really smart, huh? That's great.
Very quickly as we got out to Crab Island, it became very apparent that there were a lot of inexperienced people operating boats in close quarters, which wasn't necessarily the safest thing. Within a few minutes, we had helped somebody whose rented jet ski wasn't working or they didn't know how to operate it. I saw the anchor line in one boat get caught around the anchor of a big yacht. Despite the mustaches for the two guys on the front of the boat, this is not the TV show Cops, so I want to make a couple of points. I recorded things from that patrol boat that I don't want to put on the internet, and it's because people were out there enjoying time with their families in different states of mental awareness because of choices they had made. It's not a great look for a lot of people, and I want to respect people's privacy, so I'm not going to put that out there. But I will tell you this, I learned things I didn't know. For example, I didn't know the Coast Guard can just board your vessel and they can inspect everything you have on board to make sure you have the proper safety equipment, the stuff required by law, like fire extinguishers, flotation devices. I had no idea that they can board whether you want them to or not. One thing I just want to make abundantly clear, if you're going to be in control of a vessel on the water, it's in everybody's best interest, especially yours. Just don't consume alcohol. Just don't do it. A little later on, we were doing a boarding out on the outer edges of Crab Island, and then things got serious. There was a report that a woman out in Crab Island didn't have a pulse.
Come over here, 1018 the east side of Crab Island. There's a subject on a boat up in the middle of Crab Island that apparently doesn't have a pulse and is not breathing.
Hey, drop it, drop it, drop it!
Sail.
Back at the station, the paramedics were called. Some of the local law enforcement officers had jet skis and they could get out into the center of Crab Island. And when they got to her, suddenly she had revived on her own and she had refused medical attention.
She's awake, she's conscious, she's talking.
So it was kind of an odd, but a good outcome. At the end of the day, some folks on a boat got our attention and pointed out another boat that was in distress. It ended up that some ladies had rented a pontoon boat and it had gotten pushed by the current against the bridge and they were pinned there. So we went over to help them get free and get them back underway. And afterwards, Machachi, who's a mechanic, made sure that there was no damage to their engine and that they could operate properly. Back at the station, my buddy George was filming in the comms room when an important call came in.
Vessel handling Coast Guard Station Destin. Roger, what is your location?
30 degrees, 20, 925, 86 degrees, 30, 113.
Captain, it's Coast Guard Station Destin. Roger, can you confirm you have
all the personnel on the water?
Cast off.
So as that was happening, we could hear the radio calls going back and forth and quickly got ready to head that way.
Account for all personnel.
They're still in the water. You are working at this moment to get them on your vessel. 925?
925.
Okay. 1-2 miles south of the pass.
You're going to hang on, Justin!
Yes, sir!
We took off out to sea, and I quickly began to appreciate why they usually use the larger response boat medium when they head out of the harbor out into the ocean. It was a heck of a ride, and even with the built-in shock absorption, man, it was a lot. We heard over the radio that everyone was safely retrieved from the water by the captain of the Adeline, so I cannot imagine how stressful this ride would have been out to the sinking vessel, knowing that people might have been in danger. It would have been a very different mood.
How far out are we going?
2 more miles!
2 more miles?
Yeah!
Oh yeah! Holy crap!
It was a very long 2 miles, and thankfully when we got there, the captain of the Adeline was headed back in with all 8 boaters on board.
So this boat just flipped up. I had sunglasses somewhere. This boat just capsized. 8 people were on it. A good Samaritan picked them up. And so what are you guys doing now?
We're just picking up debris. We're gonna stay in the location for a little while just to make sure we don't hear anything. Maybe someone trapped in the hull or something, we can hear them. But we're pretty sure we heard from the source that there were 8 people in, 8 people out. Everyone's accounted for. So yeah. We're just picking up debris at this point.
Oh, some dude wants these shoes, man.
Yeah, those are. Where's the other one?
It's over there.
Oh, yes.
How fun would it be to take a guy's shoes back?
That would be cool.
Just to bring it back and be like, hey, we got shoes.
Hey, you forgot
these. Thanks for paying your taxes.
They were on your boat that you also forgot.
Let's go. How crazy would it be to get his other shoe, man? That'd be freaking awesome.
It was right there.
Shoe. Shoe number 2.
Oh, let's go. Nice. You got it.
Hat.
There's the other one right there, Justin.
All right, so a boat sank. They're trying to get the numbers off of it. There were 8 souls aboard. They made it in. That's good. Nobody's hurt. Now they're thinking about the environmental issues, such as oil in the water, stuff like that. So right now they're trying to get the registration number off of the boat.
A salvage company was contacted to come refloat the boat, and we made our way back to Station Destin and tied up. But the funny thing about getting the shoes and the hat is we actually got to give the captain those things back. And I'll show you that in just a minute. This episode of Smarter Every Day is sponsored by Brilliant, which is an amazing way for you to learn key STEM concepts from the ease of your phone, or it's also a website. And the thing I love about Brilliant is that it's interactive. Calculus, probability, logic, whatever it is you want to learn, it's all there, and you can deep dive into it with interactive modules that help you own the content. Brilliant has thousands of lessons with exclusive new content added monthly. If you want to learn this stuff, you don't have to spend a ton of money on college courses. You can do it with Brilliant. You can own the content by interacting with it and getting a firm grasp of these concepts. Brilliant helps you think better, which will help you solve any problem. So this is an investment in your brain, which is one of the most important things you can invest in as a human. I try to get smarter every day, and if you don't have a plan to do that, please consider going to brilliant.org/smarter every day. Go to that link, you get to sign up for free, and Brilliant has guaranteed me the first 200 people will also get 20% off their annual premium membership. I don't know when they're going to cut that off, but if you're considering it, you might want to do it sooner rather than later. A huge thanks to Brilliant for supporting Smarter Every Day, and a huge thanks to you for considering supporting the sponsor.
You know, cause my daughter-in-law, she's 5 months pregnant, and thank God that was cool was there, and then I got her up on the boat.
Oh, those are shoes, man.
Man, I really want to keep that.
That's Josh's hat. Shoes. Marcia's hat, that's she's going to love it, man.
That's awesome.
She goes, you got your hat on? Oh, this is too funny.
So is it your boat?
Yeah, it's mine, man.
Yeah. What happened, you know?
We're just out there on anchor fishing.
Yeah.
Lines were just going and going. I was like, you know what, man, screw this. It was starting to come over the back, you know, with the wave breaking over the back. And I'm like, you know what? So all of a sudden the boat just automatically, the field just start dropping. I said, hey, is that pump? You know, he said, yeah, it's pumping. Yeah. And I tried to, all I know it, man, is if it was like, it just starts like this and then just like this. And I mean, just literally.
It just went?
Like this.
Was it scary?
Yeah, I wasn't having much time to think about it.
Well, me,
I
for myself.
Hang on. I got off the boat. I rolled with the boat. And then I just hung on to it. And
you guys were able to get out and get life jackets on all that?
Well, no, I couldn't. Okay, that's the stupid thing about it. You couldn't get the life jackets out quick enough as fast as the boat went down. Now, I'm former 82nd Airborne, so I've jumped out of perfectly good airplanes. I'm not afraid of anything. But when that went over, first thing was my daughter-in-law with my grandson, you know, having to carry my grandson and my son. that was a part, and I got mentally exhausted because I'm looking around trying to find her, but trying to stay
alive. And y'all were treading water.
Yeah.
I'm grateful that this man and his whole family, including his grandson, who's now been born, made it through this experience. And I'm grateful that a good Samaritan on the Adeline was out there and able to get to him so fast. It's a good day for the Coast Guard when all they have to do is manage the cleanup on a bad situation and no one is missing or lost. But I'm grateful for these men and women who were there waiting and ready for the call. A huge thank you to you for checking out the Deep Dive series here on Smarter Every Day with the Coast Guard. Got more videos coming. Please consider subscribing if you want to check that out. Also, a huge thank you to everybody that supports on Patreon. I have a surprise coming up soon for patrons. So if you want to check that out, patreon.com/smarter every day. That's it. I'm Destin. I'm grateful for you. You're getting smarter every day. Have a good one. Bye.